everyone. All the presidential candidates here. Lark's here, Hugh here, Hugh's here, and Hashmat. Cool, we'll come up to the front and let's get underway. So just while the candidates are coming on stage, just a few notes. Popper's Pizza will be coming at 1:30 p.m. So thank you to Popper's. Just a note that we will not stop the forum when the pizza arrives. Two or three people will walk around and hand out the pizza, or you might kind of have to get up, but we don't want a big interruption. So just try and remain quiet during that time. The other thing to say is, I am sure you will all do this, but there is a bit of noise in the background, so if you're sitting in here, just try and be as quiet as possible, because it can be difficult as a candidate trying to hear and speak over the noise. So basically how today's forum will work is that the candidates will start by getting 3 minutes to introduce themselves and say what they want for that period of time. We'll then move into an alternation between questions for particular candidates, but also doing some short answer questions where we sort of get a direct yes or no answer from the candidates on their views. And then once that's finished, and I feel like we've covered all the major topics, there will be an opportunity for questions from the audience. Yesterday I forgot to note that if you are in the audience, it is often the case that you are affiliated with one of the candidates in some way or another. So please do ask that. And I'll try and spread it out, but try not to lump a whole lot of questions that are attacking or going to a particular candidate on something. If that does happen, I will just sort of act as the other side and try and defend them if that's possible. Okay, so without further ado, have you got... You've got the mic, Lark? Cool. Oh, can everyone hear me? Do you want to test yours first, Lark?
Hello?
Can everyone hear Lark?
Okay, Lark, without further ado, you have 3 minutes to introduce yourself.
Hi everyone, my name is Lark Hare and I'm my fifth year of a law and accounting degree. I'm in my final semester, so I'm on the way to the final finish line. I want to be your president because I think that what I can bring to the executive is something different, new and fresh. I have the leadership qualities and skills. I want to be out on the ground, I want to meet you guys. I want this time next year you to say, oh yeah, I know my president, she's called Lark. Yeah, I see her all the time, she's everywhere. That's what I want and that's what I can achieve as your president. The main policies that we're really running with on the Your Voice ticket is an OUSA food truck. I know it has been the source of some contention in these forums and with some other candidates, but I hope to clear that up today and I'm sure I'll get the opportunity. We're also running on an approachable executive. I will be at every single hall in the first month of next year. I will meet with every single club at this university. They're absolutely key and crucial to us. We are not just here to learn and sit in lectures, we're here to engage and get involved in Dunedin. And clubs is an awesome way of doing that. And I'm going to be there, I'm going to be an advocate for clubs, and I'm going to be involved. Other things that we're running on as well is welfare of students. So things like flatting packs, ideas like Dunedin Explorers. How many people here have truly gone out and explored what Dunedin has to offer? It's so easy to stay inside your little North Dunedin bubble, and it's much harder for students to see what further opportunities Dunedin has to offer. A lot of people come here, have a great time here, get a degree, go to Wellington or Auckland. We don't want that. We want you to know what Dunedin is. And as your president, that's what I'll bring. And so I hope that this election, coming Monday, you'll vote Lark for President of OUSA 2017.
So my name is Hashmat, and I study law and politics. And the main thing that I want to run on this year is that increasingly I've seen OUSA is becoming more and more of a shell. OUSA in the past has been an institution. From our coat of arms, we got a coat of arms straight after the university in 1948, I believe. And so the coat of arms represents something that's ingrained within the city, ingrained with the students, and ingrained in the minds of students. And so, increasingly what we see is happening is that OUSA, they do a very good job in providing events and stuff like that, and all the services that OUSA contracts them out to do. But what we don't see is an OUSA that's really involved in what students want to happen. And so I don't like the term debate. I know this is a debate. I don't like the term debate. I think there needs to be more conversation between all of us up here and with students in general. And there needs to be collaboration. And we need to work towards something. And I think not for you guys so much because you guys are here, but for the 20,000 other people who are out there, if we don't who don't want to come here and who aren't as involved in OUSA, we really need to find something that makes them want to vote and want to stand up and raise their voices. And I really think that something like that, and I've gone around the past couple of days and I've gotten names and I've asked people what they want. And the two key things have been a zero fees scheme, and New Zealand First has come out and said that, and also better health and wellness services.
Thank you. Good evening, guys. So my name's Hugh Baird. I am a commerce student, and this year I have been the current editor of your magazine, Critic. In that role, I've worked very closely with OUSA and the executive, and I've seen the job that they do. I've attended the executive meetings, I've been to the university council meetings, and whilst I've seen some of the good things that they've done, I've seen some of the bad things that they've done, or things that they haven't done so well, and things that I think I can do a little bit better. As the editor of The Critic, I've had the pleasure of leading the team that we've got there to produce the 48-page magazine each week, and I think that I have been able to build the skills that I think are necessary for this role. So, as President Nick said, there's a few initiatives that we'd like to run on. The first would be to oppose any party registered inside North Dunedin. We think that the students here have the best culture of any university in New Zealand. I think it's something that we're very proud of, and it's the envy of every other university in the country. But we think that some of the freedoms and the rights that the students have at the current moment might be taken away from them. And we work very hard to strongly oppose those and walk away from any of those agreements. The second would be for longer library hours during exam periods. I think one of the things that the exec did very well this year was implement the 24-hour study space. And we think that the time for OUSA to implement them is over. It's time for the university to start to step up and open the library for longer hours during the exam period to accommodate all types of studiers. The third is rubbish collection, more frequent rubbish collection. We think it's absolutely ridiculous that you get given a bin, a little blue bin the size of your shoe, to put 14 days worth of bottles in. We'd like to see that more students or more flats given more bins with more frequent pickup services. And the fourth would be introducing a wellbeing fund. We think obviously that students, they suffer a lot of struggles, and we'd like to introduce a lot of wellbeing sort of things, such as free giveaways, pizza and the link, just to prep up the student morale a little. So thank you very much.
Cool, thank you to the candidates for their introduction. The first question, I only want a 30-second answer from each candidate on. Yesterday we had a range of views about what the role of OUSA should be. We had Will at one end of the spectrum who said OUSA needed to be louder and a bigger advocate and challenge the university more. We sort of had Bryn, who's on Lark's ticket, was kind of in the middle, saying that there were times when OUSA needed to stand up, but other times where OUSA should work with the university. And then we had Cody, who was the sole finance candidate, who said that the days of OUSA being a union are over, and OUSA should concentrate on providing services to students. So with reference to those positions, and it would be helpful, Hashmat, if you indicate sort of where you sit in that, given you're not on one of those tickets, just describe what you think in 30 seconds the role of OUSA should be.
Well, obviously I'm with Will Guy there. It's a fantastic position, Will. We think that it should be a lot stronger a voice, a more independent voice, not caring to the university's concerns or, you know, whatever the university wants. With stuff like humanities, I think we need a strong university union that stands up to the university and says, look, we don't want these sorts of humanity cuts. And just to be stronger, more independent.
Hashmat?
I'm actually with him on that one. We do need to stand up more, and OUSA needs to stand up for students more. But I do think also with Lark's one that we can't act like children. So we need to act like adults in order to be taken seriously. And that means that we need to stand up for ourselves, and then there's things that we cannot back down on, but we also need to understand that we have a supply agreement with the university and our funding comes from the university.
Cool, thanks Hashmat. Lark?
I obviously agree on the balanced approach. I think there's a time and a place to stand and stomp your feet and kick up a fuss and carry on, you know, maybe like a child, I don't know, it depends on who you are. But there is a time for that, and there's also a time for collaboration. There's a time to communicate effectively and cooperatively, and there's a time to be strong in your position, but be strong in your position with the ability to communicate that effectively on places like the University Council. There are processes that university goes through, and if you go through their processes that they have designed, then you're much more likely to get a better outcome than kicking up a fuss and creating a ruckus.
Cool, thanks, Lark. So you all, to an extent, think that OUSA needs to advocate on behalf of students directly to the university. Whoever of you gets elected president will have a meeting with the Vice-Chancellor. I want to know, in that meeting, what are the you only have time to raise two or three issues. What are those two or three issues that you're going to raise in the first meeting? We'll start with you and come back down the line.
One of the issues would be the freedoms and rights of students, certainly around such things as the party register or the North Dunedin liquor ban. We think that, you know, students aren't petulant little children. They should be allowed their own freedoms. And sometimes I think the university, they just cower a bit, they mother a bit, and they don't give the university students the freedom to move and to, you know, sort of grow as students. So I think that would be the major issue I'd be bringing up with the Vice-Chancellor.
What specific policy, though, will you be advocating for changing? So when you're saying to her, you know, the university needs to be more hands-off, what specifically do you mean by that?
I just mean in regards to such stuff as saying, look, that they need to be bringing in CCTV footage or, you know, the party register. I'd be strongly opposing those sorts of policies and saying, look, that's not what we want as students. We think we need freedoms and our liberties protected.
Cool. Hashmat?
Very first thing would be we need to figure out a way to cut these student fees down for domestic students and international students. And the second one is we really need to do something about the rates of depression and suicide amongst young people, specifically because we are at a university and that is one of the main things that young people are fighting these days in New Zealand as a whole.
And do you have any specific way you think uni or OUSA could improve and support students' mental well-being?
No, I don't actually. I think that would be an executive creative meeting and we'd need to come up with some stuff.
Cool, thank you. And Lark?
The two key things that I would discuss with the Vice-Chancellor would be, number one, communication with the students. And that's where I think OUSA really, really comes into its own. And that's so we get the student perspective, so we find out what the students actually want. It's all great and good as having a perception of what we think they want or having a referendum, but being out there discussing, chatting with students in the link, in the clubs, in the colleges, that's where we're going to get the real, true opinions. The second one also is mental health, and I do agree with Hashmat on that, but I do have ideas on how we could fix it. My idea would be to create a club that's known as Dunedin Explorers, Dunedin Adventurers, whichever you want to call it. And I think it's about prevention, not fixing the solution after it's happened. I want people to feel more like they're part of a Dunedin community and not just going between Castle Street and their lecture hall. It needs to be more inclusive and more collaborative.
Thank you, Lark. Cool, now that we're warmed up, we're really going to get into it. And I'm going to, we should start back with Lark. And I'm going to pose a question on perceived weaknesses that have both come up in debate, but also people have just been talking about generally. So Lark, I want to give you a sort of 30-second opportunity to explain the food bus policy, because yesterday it was a little changing in terms of what it meant. So initially, it sounded like maybe it was providing just food to starving students. Then it sort of became a measure that would be in operation on a Thursday and Saturday night to make the streets safer. And then by the end, it was sort of said that you wouldn't implement the policy if it's too expensive. So I'm just going to give you 30 seconds to explain what this food bus looks like.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Paul. I'm delighted to be able to explain it. It's not just a couple of lads with a barbecue out on Castle Street, as some people think. That's illegal. What it is, it's a professional business. It's going to be a professional business model. It's Thursday night. It's 11 o'clock. Students are on Castle Street, Hyde Street, Dundas Street. They're spilling out their flats. They're making their way to town. They're probably going to stop up at McDonald's on the way. Before they get there, there's going to be the OUSA food truck. And what it's going to be selling is cheaper options of what students want. So nuggets, chips, whatever it is. They'll all be at price points of like $2 or $3. It's going to be cheap and it's going to be accessible. It's going to sober people up, so it's going to be a safety mechanism. We're also going to be handing out water. We can be encouraging people to have a sit down or maybe just pop back into your flat. It's eyes on the street. We will also help with the rubbish problem of glass on the streets. We'll have big bins. Huge big bins for people to pop their glass in as they come out of their flats. It's a safety mechanism, it's what the students want, and it's saving the students money. And that's what the food truck is.
Do you have an idea of how much it'll cost per year?
I imagine the initial startup cost will be at the upper end of about $70,000. And then from there, it's expected to, at the very least, break even, if not make a small amount of profits, which can be put back into the students through OUSA.
Hashmat, do you support the idea that Lark's proposing of a food bus?
I think it's a good idea to get out there and have eyes on the street to see that people are okay and stuff like that. And I think OUSA does something along those lines currently, if I'm not mistaken, with the Are You Okay people? No?
That's not on a Thursday and Saturday night, but at specific events. But isn't that maybe one of the criticisms, that there already is people out on the street? There's Campus Watch,
maybe there's
Red Frogs. So what's the additional benefit that this will have?
Campus Watch is a separate issue entirely, but maybe we can extend the already available services that we have.
Yeah. Hugh, what do you think of the food bus proposal?
For $70,000, do you know how many chops you could get on the grill? Instead of something like that, we'd be happier just to put barbecues on those sorts of areas and hand them out. I don't think you need to be spending $70,000 of student money on a food bus that would roam around, where you could just go slap down the barbecue, do the same sort of thing, or even just come to some sort of agreement with those food trucks that are around, putting tabs on those sorts of things and working with them in a much cheaper alternative.
So the food truck itself is a good idea then?
Well, giving food to students on a Saturday night, Thursday night is a good idea, but I just don't think you need to invest $70,000 into a bus. Where you could get out there, chuck some latex gloves on yourself, and start flipping some chops.
Cool, alright. Now we're going to Hashmat's perceived weakness, but we'll get the others to comment as well. So everyone has said that they're really impressed by the calibre of all three candidates, and most people I speak to would be happy with any of you as president. The concern that people have for you, Hashmat, is that Lark's got a ticket, Hugh's going to have a lot of mates out for them. Have you got a big campaign machine which is going to help you win?
I don't know what the exact definition of a campaign machine is.
How many people are helping you?
That group sitting on the corner right over there. Shout out. Make some noise.
Cool. So you think you got enough support, enough people helping you?
The thing is, it's less about, the whole point is about going out there and getting student votes. Last year's election, you had over 3,300 votes or something like that, if I might be mistaken. So it's not just about me getting my mates to come and vote for me and having a, that's the election machine. It's about that group of people going out and telling people that elections are happening and you need to vote. And we've been doing that the past couple of days, and you'd be surprised at the amount of people who don't know that elections are actually happening.
Cool. And I just want to clarify for everyone sort of who they're running with. Are you backing any other candidates, or are you just entirely independent?
I don't know if I'm backing any other candidates, but some of my mates are running for other positions.
Who are they?
Eden and Sina.
Oh, cool. And what positions are they running for?
I'm pretty sure one is running for colleges and the other one for
campaigns. Cool. Hugh, who are you running with, and who's helping your campaign?
I'm running with Will Guy, who's running for Vice President. Couldn't think of a better man for the job. He sat on the executive this year as the Recreation Officer, and I think he'll do a fantastic job next year. He knows the ins and the outs of the organisation and the position.
Cool. And Lark, who are you running with, and who's supporting you?
I am on the Your Voice ticket, and I'm running alongside Britain for Education, James for Colleges, Danielle for Welfare, and Max for International.
Okay, cool. We'll go to Hugh now. So Hugh, many people have said to me that they are somewhat surprised that you're running with Will, and that you have maybe had a bit of a transformation. We've seen you out supporting the divestment campaign yesterday. But some would suggest that maybe the combination of you and Will is a bit of a cynical political move to ensure that the campus left are assured that you are in fact progressive, feminist, a unionist, and the young Labour kind of backing, they want to look a bit cooler by leveraging off your scarfy appeal. Do you think that's true?
Paul, I just don't know what you're on about. No, absolutely not. I just think Will's a fantastic person to run along with. He's got some fantastic ideas. He's helped me a hell of a lot with my campaign. And all of those ideals which you suggest I've changed to, Paul, I don't know what you're on about. They've always been things that I've thought are important, especially to the student body here.
Cool. I want to ask everyone about divestment, so we'll just leave the mic at Hugh and come down. So yesterday, it was said in part two of council that the university divested. I just want to know whether you think that is something to celebrate, or whether more work needs to be done, because the majority of the university investments are in the uni trust rather than from uni council. And uni trust last year wrote in a clause that said they would discourage investments in fossil fuels and alcohol, tobacco, munitions. That doesn't mean that they're banned or they're not going to invest in them. So I'm just wondering whether you think that what's happened so far is enough, and if it is enough, what's the benefit if nothing has actually changed?
Well, obviously...
If they haven't completely committed to it, obviously not enough has been done. I think divestment is an incredibly important topic. And I think that the way that you see the world going now, it would be good to divest away from those fossil fuel types of things and start investing in renewable energy sources, which seem to be the way of the future. So I think it's important to keep lobbying those other groups to see if we can get a complete promise that they won't be investing in those sorts of assets.
So will you be lobbying, because bear in mind whoever wins the presidency is on uni council automatically now, will you be lobbying for the trust to have a stronger divestment policy than it does?
Yes. I think divestment is the way of the future.
Cool. Hashmat?
I can't say that I know enough about divestment or what happens with uni council or uni trust, as you said, but generally, the way I see renewable energy, if you take Tesla for example with the electric cars, Tesla has now become the largest manufacturer of lithium batteries. And I'm not a science dude or anything like that, but I recently read that lithium, the production of lithium batteries, is worse for the environment than carbon emissions. And so maybe it's less to do with finding renewable energy and more to do with, in a consumerist society, how do we use less energy? Because I think that's at the core.
specifically though, is still 2.75 million invested by the uni trust in these areas where they've said they're discouraging investment. Would you be lobbying for a stronger policy, or do you think the word discourage investment in those areas is sufficient?
Discouraging is political language for we're not really going to do it.
Yep. And that's the point I'm trying to make. Yeah. So do you think that they need to do more?
So if it, as you said, if it really is the way of the future, then they ought to be doing it. As I said, I don't know enough about it to say anything.
Okay, cool. Lark, what do you think about divestment?
I think with any investment at all,
as an accounting student, obviously I think with any investment that you're going to have at all, there needs to be a weighing up of pros and cons. And obviously with fossil fuels, there's huge, huge cons. I would be in support of the University Trust having some stronger language to discourage.
Okay, excellent. Now we're just going to do a quick fire round where I want you to answer yes or no. Under your presidency, that might be a good point, is Jerome here? Cool. It might be good to get that mic fixed, but this is just a yes or no, so you can yell it out. Under your presidency, will OUSA continue in NZUSA, or will it consider withdrawing and start to lie and go down?
You can't explain.
You can have 10 seconds.
Yes, but it needs to be reworked into a more usable model that's going to work for us as OUSA and as students across the nation.
Cool. Hashmat?
I'm with Lark.
Oh, no further addition. Hugh?
Yes, I think it's important in election year, but I'd like to see a lot more transparency in what they're doing, especially communicating back to the student body.
Cool. Okay, now I want to talk to all the candidates about fees. Some of you have already mentioned it, and we discussed it yesterday in reference to council voting, I believe, 10-2 to put the fees up by 2%. So just starting with a quick question for all, do you support or oppose the decision to increase the fees? And just briefly justify that position.
Only if we were to see
adjustments in the money that the OUSA was getting from the university. So I would say yes to an increase in fees so long as OUSA was getting more money and our budget was frozen.
So it's okay for OUSA to ask for more money and charge a higher fee to students, but it's not okay for the uni to charge a higher fee for students and their papers.
No, so if the fees were to go up, I would expect OUSA to be getting more money and not have a frozen budget.
But doesn't that just mean students are paying even more now? Hashmat?
I would be a definitive no. I do not want any fee increases whatsoever. I think being in the election year next year, I think the political parties are looking for the young votes, so they've already raised it as a fringe issue, and I think if OUSA takes a strong position on it, and along with other student associations around the country, as we take a strong position, and as our students begin to back it, it's going to come out of the fringe issue and become a real policy point.
Cool. And Lark, your view on the 2% increase?
No one likes to see an increase in fees. We don't like to see an increase in any kind of cost that is going to, you know, drain our pockets. I think what's more of a problem for students, though, is the day-to-day costs of living. And your fees going up by 2%, how that's going to affect your loan overall for, you know, however long you're here for, is kind of an afterthought for students. I think more at the forefront of their mind is you're only getting $178 a week, near and about, and people want more money week to week, and I think that's where the effort needs to be put into.
Okay, I now want to ask you all about the Labor Party proposal for 3 years tertiary free, and it's probably important to point out that that applies not just to university but other tertiary institutions like Polytech. So starting with Lark and going down, there was a bit of discussion about this yesterday, so I went away and checked, and the Labor Party policy says, quote, their policy will not affect the living allowance or course-related costs. And some of you have mentioned throughout your campaign that you think the allowance and course-related costs are actually very important. So I want to know, what do you think is the biggest barrier or inhibitor to study out of the day-to-day living costs, or is it actually the total sum that you have to pay to go to uni? So we'll start with Mark and then work our way down to Hugh.
I think because it's the here and now, it's the day-to-day living costs that really affect us as students as we are now. Our loans are something that we will deal with for the rest of our lives, which I think is an incredible burden, and I do agree with having 3 years of a free degree. New Zealand First has put out a policy where you work back for your degree, so you have a year of university, you give a year back, and so on until you've paid it off, and I'm in support of that one as well.
Okay, do you think OUSA should be advocating that students vote Labour because of that policy?
No, I think what's really important for OUSA as an organisation is to encourage voting. I think they should be encouraging students to vote and to take considered thought into their votes and to consider thought as to how that affects their lives today and how that's going to affect their lives tomorrow, 5 years, 10 years, 50 years. I think that OUSA taking a specific standpoint is alienating some students to take a different standpoint, and I think it's unnecessary in the circumstances.
Okay, thank you. Hashmat, barrier to tertiary education, is it the day-to-day living costs or the total sum you have to pay for all of the uni papers?
Well, I don't think there's a very big barrier to tertiary education. Tertiary education is now a business, and everybody feels, I was talking to I think Golda over met her the other day as well, that it's become, tertiary education has become something you do, so everybody does it. So,
is that a good thing?
Well, of course it's a good thing because it leads to a more educated society, a higher educated society, but not if the level of education is coming down in order to get more people in. Because now they're saying that an undergraduate degree from about 50 years ago is worth about the same as a master's degree now.
You're saying students are having to work harder to get the same results?
Students are having to work longer, and that is to keep them at university, and that is to get that cash.
And same question as I asked Lark, do you think OUSA should be saying to students, Labour have a policy which could be beneficial for you, you should consider voting Labour?
I think OUSA should be saying that you should vote, and you should take your situation into consideration when you're voting. I think it becomes a grey area when you start telling 25,000 students which way to vote. Like she said, you're gonna sideline a considerable amount of people, and that's the people who you're supposed to be representing. So when you make political alliances like that, it's a little bit.
Okay, and Hugh, your view on what is the bigger barrier, the day-to-day living costs? Total cost of the papers?
I think, Paul, without any shadow of a doubt, it's the day-to-day living. It's pretty tough when you get $175 or thereabouts dollars each week. You're paying $135, $140 rent, you're paying $30 grocery, and you've got very little left at the end of that week. It means that students are having to work longer hours. It means that, you know, it's detracting from the amount of study that they can do or the amount of, you know, time and effort they can put into their study. So I think it's a much larger issue is the day-to-day or the week-to-week student allowance, student loan problem.
Okay, and so in a world where a political party comes out and says that they will have a universal allowance or significantly increase the amount of course-related costs you can get, do you think OUSA should be saying, actually, you should consider that as a potentially good option as well and be advocating for that, no matter what party it was?
Yeah, absolutely. I think any, you know, fees that help the week-in, week-out student, you know, to buy food, pay for their rent, you know, any other expenses that I've got is always a positive for students.
Okay, cool. We'll go back to Lark. We're still on the topic of fees. So fees are obviously intricately related to the size and services of the academic departments. And there's been a lot of discussion in the last few years about the design school and more recently humanities having to have fewer academic staff in their division. What I want to know your view on is, do you think OUSA should be vocal in opposing those cuts, or do you think that it is just like a natural result of less students studying those courses?
I think what's really important for OUSA is to be a voice for all students. So With these cuts, there has been a 20% decline in the number of people enrolling into these humanities degrees. And that's the issue that they're having. There just isn't the money available to keep certain papers open. So people aren't losing whole divisions. People are losing certain papers. There's just slightly less options in certain divisions. And we have a situation currently where departments that are earning more money because they've got more people are sub-funding other departments that don't have that same amount of money. So overall, the student benefit is losing. And I think that is it's a problem. Unfortunately, I think that it has come to this where humanities cuts are going to be made, and obviously people are going to be made redundant, and I think that's incredibly sad and sad for their careers. However, for the overall student good, it's probably going to benefit more of us in the long run.
Thank you. Hashmat, should OUSA be opposing department cuts, or is it just a natural result of students choosing to study different subjects?
I think OUSA should stand up to the departmental cuts because, I hate to say it this way, but you said that it's as a result of students enrolling into those courses, right? But it's also, you also have to understand is that with humanities, the jobs that are available, the careers that are available, are limited in what you're gonna do, and that's why people are going to sciences and stuff like that. Now it's the university's job because we're a holistic university, so we're not simply a science university. And you said for the greater good of students, and for the greater good of students, for students as a whole, humanities has always been like the soul of education. Physics didn't start without metaphysics. Without the metaphysics of Aristotle, physics could not have happened. And metaphysics is entirely humanity. And so to say that we're going to take to, and it's the university's job, if there isn't enough money, it's the university who's supposed to allocate that money to them.
Where are they supposed to get that money from, though? If they're not getting it from the government and you don't support fee increases, where's the money?
Well they're getting the money from me right now, aren't they?
You don't support them increasing the fee. Like, to cross-subsidise department, you obviously need to have some kind of surplus.
I don't agree with them spending $50 million on a new animal lab either. You can spend that $50 million in funding the careers of teaching staff, and for them to feed their families. It's not simply that their careers are over. It's we're living in tough times where jobs are hard to find, and we're making people redundant. They have no source of income. How are they going to feed their families? Yeah, we're a student organisation, but we need to look at the university as a whole. The university is the biggest employer in the city. We need to take care of our staff too.
Okay, thank you, Hashmat. Hugh, your view on whether OUSA needs to be advocating against departmental cuts, or is it just a result of students choosing different subjects?
Well, you've got university students coming to you as an association like that, and they're saying they've got concerns around their degrees and the departmental cuts. I think it's your job as the advocate of the students to be, you know, speaking on behalf of the students. And in the case of the humanities, I know there's a hell of a lot of students that are opposed to these cuts. And so I think it should be the job of the association at the current moment to be opposing these cuts. I think the humanities department does a hell of a lot of good work. They've got seven of the top ranked departments inside the university, which I think brings students here just on the reputation of the university. And I think that the humanities department does a hell of a lot for other departments as well. If you read Critic this week, our fantastic co-worker Lucy Hunter wrote a fantastic piece about how, you know, if you're a doctor, you'll be a better doctor if you do, you know, the history of medicine and all those sorts of degrees. So I think, you know, it's not just the humanities departments which is suffering, it's also other departments around it.
Okay, I've got one more round in relation to fees issues, but just to break it up a bit, I just quickly want a yes or no on whether you support the university implementing CCTV cameras for security safety reasons.
No.
Who's a no? Hashmat?
I don't, in terms of the fact that we don't want to extend the code of conduct outside of the university's grounds. The issue that we have, though, is that there's a 50-50 divide, and this was put to a poll last year, 50-50 divide on what the situation should be, and the issue is that students are having things like their cars bashed in, their letterboxes ripped out of their ground, things stolen from them, and so students want it for a safety concern, students are being harassed in the streets, and they want to have it as a safety concern, but then there's also the situation where it's a breach of privacy. So I think it's a really, really tricky issue, and I think it's something that would need to be put to the student voice once again.
We are going to do a whole round on student behaviour, so I know you want to say something, Hashmat, but we'll just finish off the fees from another aspect. So I've looked at it from the aspect of the departments. The final aspect I want to look at fees from is the salaries of university staff. So the bulk of the increase goes towards wage increases. So yesterday, $4.1 million of the 2% increase will go to academic salaries, and then $3.1 million to salaries for general staff. Shouldn't students in OUSA be supporting wage increases for staff? Because staff are the people who provide education. If you don't want fee increases, you don't want wage increases for the staff. What do you guys think?
I think that as far as the staff are concerned, I think the higher wage you pay, you're probably going to get a better quality staff. For a lot of people, in deciding what job they're going to have or where they're going to go, a lot of that will come down to the salary for people. And so if we're threatened to lose academics because we're not paying them enough, in those circumstances, then that's probably a good appropriation of the 2% rise.
Hashmat?
We have the best university in the world. We have the best lecturers in the world. And what we need is those lecturers are willing to stay. We encourage them to stay, and we don't make the ones who are other ones who are willing to stay redundant. With the fee increases funding the can I ask the audience? How much does the Vice Chancellor get paid? Can somebody shout it out? How much does the Vice Chancellor get paid per day?
$1,300
per day. I think that's enough said.
So in your meeting, in your first meeting that we talked about earlier, will you be saying directly to the Vice Chancellor, you said OUSA needs to stand up to the university, will you say to her, you need to be paid less?
I will say it to her like an adult and like the president of OUSA, and who will have a working relationship with it for an entire year. That's how I'll bring up that.
Good. What's your thoughts on that one? Does the Vice Chancellor need to take a cut?
No. I think she does a hell of a job and probably deserves the pay that she gets. But I think we want the best academics here, and we want to pay them the best or a competitive wage compared to other universities. So I would not be opposed to salary increases for those sorts of positions.
So a 2% fee rise is okay, isn't it? Because it used to be 4% and it's been cut to 2%. So is it even that big a burden?
No, and especially not when I don't think you see inflation so low at the current moment.
Cool. And just given you didn't get to express a view like your view on the Vice Chancellor's salary.
I think that's a really, really touchy subject, and I know that I, for one, would not be walking into her office day one in the position of OUSA president and telling her that she needs to take a pay cut. That's not how I would approach the issue at all.
It looks like you're on your own there with that one, Hashmat. We'll move on, because I think everyone's probably a bit bored of talk about finances and fees, and we'll talk about student behaviour. So, recently in the news, there was a case of an Otago student who was set by some to get a lenient sentence. And Hashmat, you have released a video on your Facebook page advocating for a rehabilitation rather than punitive approach to justice. And you've said you think the university needs to be more hands-off from students. So I just want you to outline in 30 seconds your general view on how you think the university, but even the criminal justice system more broadly, should treat young people, whether they be university students or not.
Young offenders is a very interesting topic to discuss. I think in terms of the university, the issue that we have is that our code of conduct and the law sometimes overlap one another. And then we get a bit of a situation where sometimes people are punished twice. So once under the university code of conduct, you've got to do something, and once again under the laws that we all follow. I think that the university needs to continue its stand with the code of conduct, especially in situations with such things as couch fires. That's arson. If the courts want to deal with it and the university wants to deal with it, I think that is appropriate because it gives a bad name to all of us.
Okay, so tough on couch burners, but a more, you think they should only be punished either by the university or the justice system, it shouldn't be both.
I'm okay with there being some level of punishment in both. I know that when you're punished by the proctor, for instance, a lot of it's community service. And I think that's just a general good. If you're going to go around burning couches, then you should do some community service, absolutely. And if the judge is likely to maybe give you a fine or just to hand it over to the university anyway.
Thank you. Hashmat, what's your approach?
My problem with the justice system as a whole and the way young people are getting treated is punitive. That's the key word. A punitive system just does not work. And there's plenty of evidence for that. If you study law and you do criminal law, you see the effects of it. And there's something that's increasingly becoming popular in New Zealand, that's called therapeutic justice. And that takes in a holistic approach. So there is certain levels of punishment there, but it takes a holistic approach in the sense that why are people doing what they're doing? What caused them to do what they're doing? How can we help them to understand that what they're doing is not okay to do? And how do we work with them together so that they feel that we actually care about them enough that we want them to be better citizens, especially with students. Now you mentioned students and non-students. I think that's important. And I think, I don't know about the case that you mentioned where somebody got a lenient sentence, but I did see something on Facebook where somebody from some privileged background got a certain sentence and somebody for a lesser charge got another sentence. I think that also needs to be addressed as part of that because this idea of racial profiling does exist and it can't exist, but it needs to be done within a holistic approach, not a punitive approach. Because the punitive system just does not work, and the majority of people in prison in this country are tangata whenua, and that's just not alright.
What's seriousness of crime do you think needs to be committed before prison is used? So would you, for example, people who commit assaults or crimes against property, should they go through alternative or therapeutic system, or should they be punished?
Again, part of the therapeutic system is enough, there is punishment there. Now, I'm a law student, I am not a lawyer, and there's plenty of more skilled people around, more people with more knowledge about the law and about these issues that can come up with these solutions. But the thing is that we need to identify the problems and talk about the problems. And that's what I'm doing now, is talking about the problems. Because that video I made, I didn't make that on my own accord. We were going around and we were getting people to say the things that they're struggling with or the things that they think OUSA should advocate for. And we did that 5 minutes after somebody told us exactly what had happened, and so I decided we're going to make that video just as a voice for that student.
Okay, Hugh Hashmat's right, isn't he? Even the Deputy Prime Minister said that prison is a moral and fiscal failure. Should we be taking a less punitive approach?
Yes, obviously those are more serious sorts of offences. I think with a lot of students, if you want to go out and, you know, fill your boots by all means, but if you make an ass of yourself, you know, be prepared to face the consequences. I think it's, you know, there's small misdemeanors which I think can be handled by the university well, and, you know, that you go to the proctor, you see the proctor about your problems, and, you know, he'll sort you out for a bit of community service. But I think something like, you know, serious misdemeanors, be prepared to face the consequences like every other, you know, citizen of the same age around New Zealand. You know, it would be no different for a builder or a plumber. You know, why should it be different for a student, I feel?
So a question I want to ask you all for brief comment, and I will start using my bell now if we go over time. So I just want a 15-second response. Martin Bradbury described Otago University as a rich kid's playground. Do you agree with that? 15 seconds.
I wish. Absolutely not. I think the great thing about Dunedin is it's got students from all backgrounds. And I think they all come together and work so fantastically well, and I think we all see the consequences of that.
Same as you.
Yeah, I wholeheartedly disagree with that entirely. I think that where that really comes down to is the way students are perceived in the media. And that would be one of the biggest things that I would work on as the OUSA president, would be to get our name out in the media of all the good that we're doing. There is community service going on all around us, and it's just ignored because it doesn't make a good news story. But let's make it a good news story.
Okay, well, that's a good segue into the next aspect of this. You know, people always say, oh, we need to show the good sides of Otago students in the media. The media is not an advertising page. You can't just say, please report on this. So what I want to know, again, just in 15 seconds, what would be your strategy for positive news stories, or do you even think that's worth worth your time doing as president?
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, the fantastic work that Crick does. And obviously working probably on a more local scale with the ODT, I'd love to see implemented a column written by students every week to see what was going on, you know, positive stories from students that...
We'll finish off briefly.
Sorry, yeah. Yeah, so just basically that.
Hashmat, 15 seconds.
Positive news stories are good.
Nice and succinct. Lark.
I would foster really, really strong relationships with people like the ODT, the Star, not to forget about the smaller newspapers as well. And I think it's really, really important to have our student voice, and I would love to advocate to have something along the lines of a column or a certain section of the paper that we write every single week, and I'd encourage OUSA to do that.
Cool. Next topic. I'll give you 30 seconds for this one. So, under the Sale and Supply of Alcohol Act 2012, there are avenues which the police and university would probably love to have some case law to be able to shut the High Street Party down. So what I want to know from you is that if that was to occur, there is an attempt to shut it down, what would your response be? So starting with Lark, 30 seconds.
I think shutting it down is a bad idea. I think the way it's been run at the moment by OUSA is fantastic. I think that the regulation is positive. I think that the way it's controlled and it has negotiations with police and the like, I think that's a really positive aspect to Hyde Street. And as you've seen with Agnew, if you don't give what the students want, they'll just do it themselves. So I think it's positive for OUSA to still be involved with Hyde Street.
Cool, thank you. Hashmat?
OUSA is regulating it really well. And like Lark said, this is something that the students want, and OUSA should advocate for it.
Do students want it?
Well, if you ask the majority of people walking around here, what would they say?
Do you want it? Do you think it's a good idea?
What's a good idea?
Hyde Street.
If the students want it, it's a good idea.
Hugh?
I would do everything I possibly could, including laying down on railway tracks until they say yes to the Hyde Street Key Party, to make sure that the future of it was ensured. I think it's one of the most important events for the students of the year. You just see the lines that are coming down here, or you know how fast it sells out. It's something that students definitely want, and I think you know it's one of the most important things that we could do is to ensure the future of the High Street Key Party.
Okay, cool. Now, just to break up the stuff on student behaviour, going to do a quick fire 15 second. Should the university, or do you support the $15 million new animal testing facility? Basically, yeah, quick 15 second answer from all of you.
Yeah, absolutely I do. I think there's also a lot of research from a lot of students that I've talked about who use the facility that say they want it. They think it's a fantastic initiative. People say that there are alternatives out there instead of animal testing, but by all the people that I've talked to, there's not. It's the best source or means of testing still. So yeah, I support it completely.
Cool. Ashmat?
I think it really depends from what background you come from and what group you associate with. Because certainly all the students I've talked to, and I don't doubt the ones that you've talked to, have said that, because I did read what was in the Critic and was making fair points, that all the students I've talked to have been against.
And so you would advocate against it, or...?
I would advocate against it as long as the students keep telling me that they don't want it.
Okay, and Lark?
I think having the research facility would be fantastic in terms of putting Otago on the map even more. I think that there is potential to do incredible work with it, and I think that there is some testing that you can do via computer simulation, but there is only so much and so far that goes. The drugs that they would be giving the animals or testing things onto the animals is at the very final stages, and I think that is an important part of science and an important part of research.
Okay, the final thing under this broad heading that I would like your views on is the Craft Beer and Food Festival. So OUSA's done that 4 or 5 years now. It's an event at the end of the year, gets a pretty good turnout, but there is always a bit of discussion about whether it's a student-centric event or not. So basically I want your view within 15 seconds for this one about whether you support OUSA running and funding that festival.
110%. I've been to the last couple of years, and Dan Hendrick and the events team do a fantastic job. I think one of the best things about the Dunedin Craft Beer Festival is that it's quite good exposure for OUSA to the rest of the Dunedin public, and I think it's quite a good initiative to foster those relationships between the Dunedin public outside of the student area and the Students Association, so 110% we continue it.
Cool. Hashmat?
In the executive meeting minutes for OUSA from this year, I'm not quite sure which meeting it was, the issue did get brought up whether OUSA should be supporting putting their name to that. Now, the meeting minutes didn't have the arguments for or against, so I would need to hear the arguments for and against that to and the decision could happen after that.
Okay. Lark?
My opinion is that it's a great way of OUSA and the students getting out in the community and doing something that's not student-centric. So it's not High Street and it's not, you know, O Week and Rio Week. It's something a bit different to what anything else that OUSA does, and I think for that reason it's really positive. I think where it falls down is it's not advertised enough as an OUSA event. And I think if there's more advertising put out that it's actually an OUSA event, then it will really work to bring about a good image for the brand.
Okay, sorry, there is one final important question on this topic, and that's student safety. There's been a lot of discussion about whether Otago is a safe place to be, particularly in the evening. So two short questions. Do you think campus area is a safe place for everyone? And if you don't, what do you propose to do to improve the safety?
I think for some people, yes, campus is very safe, but I think for others, there is a concern and they do feel unsafe walking through campus. I think a lot of it is to do with the fact that it's very empty at night and that creates a bit of a problem. Further out onto the streets, I think that sometimes it can be very unsafe. I think there's harassment issues, and I think there's issues with just people being too drunk and too disorderly. And that's another thing where the food bus comes in. Your food truck rolls in, it's sobering people up, it's giving people water, it's giving Campus Watch a hub and somewhere where the students are going to be. It's going to be providing big rubbish bins, it's going to be encouraging people to have a sit or, you know, calm down or whatever, and I think it's a fantastic safety initiative that's going to help with that.
Hashmat?
It would be wrong to say that it is entirely safe, but it would also be wrong to say that it is out of hand. It most certainly isn't out of hand. Violence and discrimination and harassment and stuff occur everywhere you go. I think we spend enough money as a university on Campus Watch, and I think utilizing them in more beneficial ways should serve to decrease the problem that exists.
Well, thank you, Hugh.
Yes, I do think it is a relatively safe campus, although, of course, there's always things that can be done to improve the safety. So I'd like to see, you know, Thursday and Saturday nights, more Campus Watch numbers out on the street just to protect those who feel vulnerable. I think they already do a fantastic job, however, you know, giving people rides home, making sure everyone's all right. So whilst I think it is relatively safe, I think there's always more that you can be doing.
Cool, okay. And this is the very last round before you do concluding statements, but you will get a minute to answer these questions. So basically, what I'm looking in your answers for is kind of the skills that you think you can bring to the president's role and why you'll get into that. And I'll preface that for each of you by maybe sort of posing a perceived weakness or whether you've had the particular skill. So Hugh, you've obviously been critic, editor, and are a confident speaker and have a lot of knowledge about communicating at a broader level, but do you have the technical skills required for policy and more intricate level discussions that the OUSA president needs to have?
Yeah, I'd like to think that I do. I mean, this year as editor, I've spent a lot of time, you know, looking around the OUSA executive and seeing the job they do. I've been to the executive meetings, I've been to the youth council meetings, I've got a great understanding of, you know, things that the council do, the job of OUSA, you know, what they do through the executive meetings, the way they communicate with all the other departments inside OUSA. And I think this year, being a part of OUSA, I've built up the relationships with those inside the organisation and also those external stakeholders, you know, the local MPs, the council, and, you know, campus cops and the proctors. So I think, hopefully, if I was elected, I'd be able to take those skills into next year.
Okay, cool, thank you. Hashmat, so you're being president of, correct me if this is wrong, the Islamic? Vice president of the Muslim / Islamic Students Association this year and last year? So you've had some leadership experience. But before I noted, you sort of said all students you talk to oppose the animal testing lab. I'm just wondering, for you, how will you handle potentially a variety of views which might be of a different nature to what you're used to hearing from the people that you talk to?
That's one of the things that's important about getting students to become more active within OUSA, because we have the referenda and certain issues such as that are put to students. Now, if the referendum that, like the one that happened this year, where only 3,100 people answered the questions and participated in the referendum, if that continues, then it will be difficult for any president to make a conclusive decision based on what students really believe. So I think we really need to get out there as an executive and ask people and then get them to participate with OUSA, and then we pose a question in the referendum for that.
Cool, thank you, Hashmat. Lark, so you're being president of Rotaract this year, is that correct?
This year and last year.
Yeah. So again, the question for you is similar to Hashmat. You have had leadership experience, but what about leadership experience when people might vehemently disagree with each other? Do you think you'll have the skills to be able to lead a cohesive and united exec?
Absolutely, I have the skills to lead a cohesive and united executive. From the absolute get-go, there will be a zero-tolerance strategy for any kind of personal and professional clashes. Professional will be kept at this end, personal will be kept at that end. And we'll all agree on a mechanism and a strategy and a way of coping and dealing with that. I have the advantage of I'm not running with another VP, and therefore, when I come into the executive, the person that I'm going to be working out most closely with, I will not know. So from that perspective, the personal relationship isn't there already to be broken or to be harmed.
Okay, and I just want to give everyone sort of 15 to 30 seconds on this one. It's like sometimes when executive members have different views to the president, it's difficult because the president's the primary spokesperson, the person most often quoted in media. What will you do to ensure executive members who have different views to you on major issues are able to express themselves or are sufficiently kind of kept happy so as not to rebel?
I believe I'm a fair and equitable person, and I'm very good at listening to people, so I'm more than happy for everyone to share their views. And I think at the end of the day, if we want to get a cohesive view, it's going to have to go to a neutral poll on the issue. Obviously, there's going to be conflicts within the executive, and I'm not scared of that. I think that's positive. It means there's different ideas, different things being thrown around, and that's a good thing. But it's about how you resolve those conflicts and how you come down to get a united decision. And I believe with my skill, my friendliness, my outgoingness, I'll be able to achieve that.
Cool. I suppose I asked you sort of a similar question before, Hashmat, but what will you do specifically when, say, an executive member has a completely different view to you, it's never going to be reconciled? What will you do to keep them happy or give them a way to express that view?
Well, each executive member is also a student. And as a student, they can express what they want. As an executive, we are living in a democracy, and OUSA is democratic, so there would be voting, and what the majority of the executive, whether I like it as well, really, that's what goes.
That's a good point, isn't it? So I'll come back to Lark on it as well. As the president, are you prepared to be rolled on issues? So if your executive votes against you, are you still happy to talk to the ODT and national media advocating for a view you don't necessarily agree with?
Absolutely. The executive is a united front, and that's what's really, really important to make clear to both the executive, to the students, and to the media, and that will be put forward. If I think one way and the whole executive thinks another way, or half the executive thinks another way, then obviously we will go with what the other half the executive think, if that is the true reflection of what the students want.
Okay. Hashmat, are you prepared to be rolled by your executive and express a different view to your personal one publicly?
I think it's a strong word to say rolled.
I don't think it is. It's democracy. Yeah. It has to be a majority.
Yeah.
If you're in the minority,
if I'm in the minority,
what's your response?
Then that's fine. And I have to go out there and I have to put the opinions of OUSA executive out there, because that's what we've decided as a collective.
And Hugh, are you prepared to be rolled?
Yeah, I've got no problem with speaking for the rest of the executive. I think the role of the president is to speak as the spokesperson for the executive and for the rest of the association. If you are disagreeing on a matter and the rest of the executive vote majority against you, then I've got no problem to speaking on their behalf for that.
Okay, and just finally, before the concluding statements, that's all very well and good, but as the president, you have significant power over the agenda in the meetings, so in issues where you know the executive are not necessarily on side, you can just not put the vote as the chair of the meeting. So, are you guys committing to putting lots of issues to votes at exec meetings? Because over the last few years, we've kind of seen a decline in the number of public votes that happen on executive.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got no problem with people disagreeing with me. You should see the day in, day out at the critic office. There are arguments 24/7 where majority office disagrees with me. So I've got no problem with that. I can respect other people's opinions on those sorts of issues. And you just got to think about who you're working for, which is the student body. And it's not, yourself personally that should be coming up with these decisions.
Hashmat?
If a president goes and knowingly, when they know the executive's going to vote for something the way that they don't want, and then they don't put that on the agenda, I think that's forcefully creating division. I don't think that's the way organisations should be run at all.
It is, but my point is that we may not see that. If that happens, students may not know. So I want to see in critic what the divide is. So will you be actively putting issues to a vote?
Because if the issue requires a vote, then the vote should be taken. But like in the meeting minutes and stuff like that, on a regular basis, you'd see critic would be present and stuff like that. So I think students would hear about it, and the meeting minutes are on the OUSA website, whether people will check them or not. Maybe they need to be advertised a little bit more.
Cool. And Lark.
Yeah, absolutely, I put things to a vote. I believe everyone has an equal voice. Everyone would have an equal voice in an executive run by me, and I'd be absolutely more than willing to put everything to a vote, and I'm not a dishonest person. I wouldn't be hiding things or not bringing things to the table. If it needs to be voiced, it needs to be sorted out. It will be sorted out on an executive run by me.
Excellent. Okay, so we're now going to move into closing statements. We'll start with Hashmat this time. So you've got 2 minutes, basically, to say what you want, and then once we've done that, we'll go to audience questions.
I didn't prepare a closing statement, but what I did want to conclude, and I had a hypothesis of what was going to happen in my head in this conversation, and that was exactly that it was a conversation, and whether we like it or not, as three people sitting up here, there was a lot of areas where we united on, and I think that whoever gets elected needs to understand that, and the other two that don't get elected need to continue their involvement within OUSA, and they need to go consult with the OUSA president, because everybody here has been campaigning hard, everybody has their backers, everybody has the students that they talk to, and so they're still, whether they become OUSA president or not, they still have the voice for that group of people. And so they need to continue, and I think that's how we're going to get OUSA back to the glory days. Have a nice big OUSA coat of arms just stuck up somewhere instead of some little shoddy one on the door over there.
Cool, thanks, Hashmat. That was just a minute, so that's good, but you've got 2 minutes max if you want, Hugh.
Excellent. Well, I would love for you guys to vote for me because I'll be a strong, independent voice in and around campus, on campus matters that represents the student body. I have no problem with speaking up about what the students want, and I have no problems with going straight up to the clock tower and telling them exactly what that is. I believe I've got great credentials for this job. I believe I'm able to communicate easily with others, whether that be relevant stakeholders, lobbying, outside parties, or working with the rest of the executive or those inside OUSA. I feel that through this year at Critic, I've been able to work well with the rest of my team, hopefully. And I've learned some great leadership skills. I'd love for you guys to vote for me. I'm sure I can do a great job. And I look forward to hearing from you, hopefully next year.
Cool, thank you. And then finally, Lark.
I believe you should vote Lark to be your president for 2017 OUSA, because what I bring is something different. What I bring is a personality. I bring energy. I bring fun. I bring me as a person that will be out there, will be involved. You'll know who I am. You can talk to me. I'll visit every single college. I'll visit every single club, and I'll be involved as much as I can. I can't say I'll be running down a rugby pitch scoring tries, but I'll be on the sidelines cheering you on. And that's what you want from your president. You want a leader, you want a motivator, you want someone who's enthusiastic, and you want someone as well who has the confidence to talk to people and the confidence to be your voice for you as students. Not only that, I'm also going to bring about an OUSA food truck. And that is a fantastic initiative, an initiative of safety, an initiative of something that students want, an initiative that is going to save students money. So if you want an executive that's fun, that's engaging, that you know, and that's going to achieve and get results, then vote Lark for president, and that's what you'll have in 2017. Thank you very much.
Cool. Okay, before we get into questions, let's have a big clap for all the candidates. A great day. So just for the questioning, if you pass that one here, someone will take this round to the questions, and I will pass this mic to the relevant person. Please do, regardless of whether you're on a ticket or not, say your full name and who you are, and then do note if you are supporting or actively on one of the tickets for the candidate. So, questions in the audience? Well, one up the front here, Don.
Hi, I'm Adam, running for postgrad exec. I'm not on a ticket or currently in support of any of the other candidates. My question is aimed towards the food truck, since you brought it up here to the end. Have you considered that it might be more affordable and more feasible to look at another student or outside organisation that could possibly do this for you and simply give them a grant as part of the fundraising ability to provide them with this?
Yeah, that's a good idea and a good question. I think what the really key thing about the food truck that people are missing is it's a capital investment. It's going to add to the assets that OUSA has. And it's also going to be a way for OUSA to be out in the community. And we're going to have full control over that, which I think is really important. I think as well, people are missing the fact that it's a safety initiative and that it's going to have big bins there, Campus Watch is going to be there, it's going to be cheaper food, it's going to be handing out water, we can have Are You OK people there. It's an initiative in and of itself that I think OUSA should do for the students and to be out there with the students.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? Paul Gooley, ex-OUSA president, 1978 to 1980.
I have to remind everybody that I was...
You don't need that.
That's right. I have to remind everybody I was here before we had electricity or water and the leaf. So my question is, I've heard a discussion around the coat of arms. The university's coat of arms says, dare to be wise. What does our coat of arms have? And what would be the legacy that each of you would like to leave? I have an ego that says we build clubs and society. What would you leave at the end of it when you walk back here as an old man looking at future generation of leadership?
Okay, we'll start with life and go down the line.
My legacy will be a president that you know, a president that you were friends with, a president that you could go and speak to, a president that you liked. That would be my legacy. I want to be out there, I want to be involved, I'm going to be in the link, I'm going to be the fun president that you know that got things done and represented you in the absolute best way possible.
the code of arms. Better read again. So the code of arms says, we dare, yeah, and my legacy is going to be walking around like you are at the moment, going around everywhere, saying I am Hashmat Lafraie, President Governor, ex-OUSA President, and I am a member of every single club on this campus because I'm a life member.
Fair enough.
I'd love to be known as the president who got out there, got about everyone, was the friendly president who everyone knew, and someone who made sure that the student culture was kept intact for a few more years at least, I hope, until someone else comes along.
I just say this very quickly. What I want to say is this. OUSA, obviously I have a bias of a candidate, but OUSA today, all the life members would tell us that the calibre of this year's presidency election is as good as it's ever been for many, many years, and all of you need to encourage people to vote. We really, really, as life members, we think you've got an exciting future. Go on, everybody.
That they've done very well this year also when I was speaking. But there are some other issues which I think the OUSA exec this year hasn't done quite so well. I think they've been, the communication hasn't been quite up to scratch. No offence to anyone sitting on the exec this year, obviously. And there's been some other initiatives that I think haven't run so well, including the hard copies of photos for graduation is another one. But yeah, I commend them on the work they've done this year with the the 24-hour study space. I think that's a great initiative that we can use going forward to lobby the university.
I'd just like to rebut right back to you, Hugh. This morning on the radio, it was revealed that you weren't sure that graduation photos had actually taken place. They had. They were taken by Luke Preston Marshall. They were put on Facebook for every single graduate to take hold of. He was there for 2 hours underneath the clock tower, and you weren't aware of it. If you're not aware of these things that are going on, then you can't really criticise the exec for not doing it.
Ashmat, do you want to chime in? All right, thank you. Okay, go again. Okay, any other questions?
My question's for Lark. What do you say to the idea that some of your policies may be a little paternalistic, like moving OUSA from a representative function to a governing function?
Is there any policy specifically that you want to refer to with that?
Maybe the food truck. I mean, it's one thing, you talked about McDonald's. McDonald's is a place that's there for people when they want food, opposed to a food truck, which, you know, it's getting a little bit, you know, following people around, being at heaps of places where they know lots of people are going to be, and providing them food. It's getting a little close to trying to give them food rather than being there to supply food if they need it or want it.
I'm not too sure where you got the following people around. It's not going to be chasing people down the street. It's going to be parked up and positioned as you would expect. Obviously can't drive and fry. Yeah, the idea of it is it's going to be stationed, okay? So come 10 o'clock on a Thursday night when you're down Castle Street having a rowdy time, you've got all your glass bottles, you're causing a bit of a ruckus, it's starting to get a little bit out of hand, you're making your way to town, in rolls the food truck, it's sitting there, you're going to buy some nuggets or chips or whatever anyway on your way to town. We're providing a cheaper option, so we're giving the students what they want anyway, but cheaper. OUSA will be out there, people will be recognising it's OUSA, we'll be handing out free water, it'll be a hub for Campus Watch, it'll have big bins to help with the glass problem that we have down in Norton Eden. And so, I don't know where this idea comes from that it's going to be following people around, but it won't be. The food truck is a professional business, and that's the model that it will follow.
I just want to follow on from the question about the food truck.
What are your guys' names and who are you?
Oh, hi, I'm Miriam. I'm running for welfare. I just wanted to ask about the food truck. It's going to cost $70,000 and you're going to park it on Castle Street? How is that going to affect the rest of students that don't live around that area, aren't going to be out and about on Thursday or Saturday night? You're suggesting spending so much money and it's not going to contribute or help to a lot of students, I think that's...
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. Thank you for asking that, Miriam. $70,000, once again, it's a capital investment. That means that we get an asset, and that means that we can then use that asset to generate further incomes and further economic benefits. The idea right now that we're proposing is that it is taken out to North Dunedin, but there's no reason why it can't be taken up to Central Dunedin. There's no reason why it can't be taken to different areas of town. There's no reason why it doesn't have to just be used just at night. The whole idea behind it is that it is providing a service and a function for nighttime when other people will be buying things from, like McDonald's, and they have another cheaper option and a safety centre out in the streets. The idea with the safety as well is, where do we have the biggest problems in North Dunedin on Thursdays and Saturday nights? We don't have those big problems, you know, for the people that live up on View Street or people that are living, you know, out on High Street. People we have the problems with are generally on Castle Street, Dundas Street, around that second year party area, and that's where the food truck will predominantly be at this stage. But of course, it's open to discussion, but the whole idea behind it is for it to be out in North Dunedin at this point in time.
Cool, I think we've had this extensive discussion around the food truck now, so are there Jared's
sorry,
question?
Sorry, I have one further question on the food truck.
What ticket are you supporting?
I'll be voting here for president in my personal capacity and not as OUSA vice president. I'd just like to ask a question, sort of two-pronged. The first is actually who generated the idea for the food truck. And the second really comes down to the fact that I know one of the executive members on your ticket has been privy to those commercial discussions this year. And has that informed some of your policy? And do you think that's appropriate?
Bryn Jenkins is the man behind the idea of the food truck. Yes, he is on my ticket and he's running for education officer next year. If anyone's getting out voting on Monday, that's a good place to pop your vote. In terms of whether that's influenced me, Bryn brought the idea to me. It's his idea. I'm not claiming that as my own idea, but I fully support and I think it's absolutely fantastic. And I think that, you know, it's people are finding it as a little target, but I feel that it's easily defended. So thank you for your question, Jared. I'd also, can I say something a little further? I'd just like to ask you, Jared, have you been involved at all with any of the presidential campaigns on a personal level?
Yes, I'm personally supporting President.
Okay.
I'm just wondering for Hugh, given a lot of the criticism seem to be coming from your quarters, whether you've given an approximate percentage of what 70,000 equates to in the total OUSA budget. Where am I, Paul? I've got no clue what that would equate to in the total budget.
But isn't it
about
to argue something
to expense? I just think that $70,000 to be spent on a food truck, where you could just go out there, grab yourself a barbecue. Barbecues are portable, by the way. Go anywhere you like, set up a bin beside it, take the bin away with the rubbish, and just flip some burgers yourself. It would not be an issue. So, also, I believe that the food is still going to be... You're still going to have to pay for the food. Why not spend the $70,000 and give the people free food in the same areas and at the same times?
I'll say it once again. It's an asset. The definition of an asset is it's something that you own that's going to bring about future economic benefits. It's not just there for one night. It's an asset that can be used at other events. It can be around. It can be out in O-Week. It can be in Tent City. It can be anywhere. It's a food, mobile food truck that's going to service the students.
I think we will end the discussion on the food truck. There's a question down the back and then we'll come to Critic.
Well, hello. My name's Golda. I'm not really affiliated with anyone. I want to respond to something that Slack said. having people enroll, therefore we need to cut them, and like, no, we can't subsidize from other areas that are having more enrollment. Okay, sure, whatever. What I want to know is, what exactly do you think the role of a university is? You think it's a money-making machine? Do you think it's a place where people come for knowledge? Do you think that, you know, divisions that have a lot of resources, like, can't help out places that do need help because it's important to have that, like, cultural aspect? Sorry.
Okay, cool. And we did have a suggestion yesterday from Will, who was saying that health sciences should cross-subsidize the humanities. So I'll give you guys each a minute on this question since it's a big issue.
Thank you for your question. I think that universities have a multitude of roles. I think for a lot of people it's a way of getting out and exploring and moving out of home, especially for a place like Dunedin. I think it obviously serves as an education. People want to get a piece of paper with a degree that's going to lead to a career, so it serves as that, it's a career path. And I think for a lot of people it's about being involved in a community. And so I think it's multifaceted. I don't think you can just say people just come to uni just to get an education, because we could just do it online, really. We wouldn't have to bother coming here. So the reason we come here is for a culture and for an environment. I don't want anyone to think that I don't value the humanities. I am a humanities student. I study law. I am well involved with the humanities. I understand the importance of them. What I really think the major issue is a national perspective of what a Bachelor of Arts means. And that's where we, as OUSA, need to voice our concern and voice our ideas for change. Overall, a Bachelor of Arts is considered to be, you know, a little bit of a nothingness, which I think is a complete shame, and I think it's a completely important element of university and of life. And so I would lobby to work with other student associations to bring up the perception of what a BA is, because I do believe it is incredibly valuable. Thank you.
I think I've already made my position plenty clear.
Like I said earlier, I think I made my position pretty clear as well, but I think when we talk about the humanities division and seven of the top departments inside the university, seven of the top 10 departments, inside the university are from the humanities division. I think that that brings up the reputation of the university, and you get a lot of enrollments of people coming here just because of the university's humanities department's reputation. So I think it is the job of the other departments to help subsidise that fact.
Colleges officer. I just want to know from the three candidates, just quick fire, what kind of policies and ideas you have for first year students staying in colleges?
My ideas are that I will go and I will visit every single college. I'll be there. There will be king cuddle rooms, I think is a fantastic idea, and I know that's been trialled by yourself in colleges this year, and I think it's fantastic. I think it's really important. I think as well, the Dunedin Explorers idea. Let's get those students that come here in first year to experience more than just this campus life. I don't know about everybody else, but in my first year, I didn't really step past the octagon. And that's a real shame. There's so much more Dunedin has to offer, and I would really advocate that students go out and explore and see more.
I think that the RAs at the colleges have significant influence over their students, and it'll be difficult to go out to every single college, a student who's living in the colleges, and maybe have intricate discussions with them. But I think we can use the RAs who are well placed to begin conversations about what those first year students would need.
I think I'd like to get to the halls and give them better education of the sorts of things that OUSA offers, the clubs and societies that we've got here, what those clubs and societies have to offer the first year students, such things as Critic, Radio One, and the Are You OK teams and the volunteering opportunities that there are on campus. I think it's good to get them at first year level, get them involved, and then they'll be able to build on that in the following years as students.
Hi, I'm Joel. I'm the Chief Reporter with Critic. I wanted to get an answer from each of you as to what your position is on OUSA's continued involvement with the New Zealand University Students Association and why you believe that.
I think the question came up earlier, and I agreed with Lark on this one that we'd be for staying with the New Zealand University Union, I think it's now called Students Association. As long as there are significant, and I don't know enough about what exactly the policies that they have at the moment, but I do know that the policies that they do have don't work, because when Paul was president, he was not happy with them, and the changes didn't occur in his time. The Victoria Students Association, they weren't happy with that. And the meeting minutes of the executive, Laura, I think, indicated after a meeting at NZUSA that Auckland might have indicated that they were putting their 1 year. So there is a need for significant reform. And also, if we want to, and I'll bring this up again, that next year is an election year, and so there does need to be some sort of collective national voice for students. And maybe that's not, if NZUSA doesn't sort itself out, maybe that's not NZUSA, but there definitely needs to be some form. And the easiest one at the moment would be NZUSA, but it would need to be reformed, according to, yeah.
My perspective on NZUSA is that it's fantastic as an idea. I think the issues that we've had with NZUSA is how it's being run and how it's being organised. And I think that's why there has been a bit of backlash about being part of it. Overall, I think it is a good idea. I think we just need to work with them and work a bit more collaboratively to ensure that what it's actually doing is benefiting the students. But they bring about awesome initiatives like Thursdays in Black, which has been a fantastic initiative this year, raising awareness around sexual harassment, which is very important and very topical on campus. So yeah, I think NZUSA is an important thing to be part of, but I think it does need work in terms of how it's actually operating and how it's run. And that's something that OUSA can be part of if I'm the president.
Yes, I would like to see us stay with NZUSA, just because of the fact that it's an election year, and I think it would be a hell of a lot more beneficial for the students if we have one collective voice at a national level posing the questions to all political parties. But I think there also needs to be a hell of a lot more transparency in what NZUSA does, not just when it's communicating to the executive, but communicating back to the student body. I think if you'd go around campus and ask them what NZUSA does, there'd be a lot of people scratching their heads. I think more transparency in what they're doing, and if not, obviously there's always the threat of leaving.
Hello, my name's Lucy, I'm the Deputy Editor at Critic. I'm not a student, so I won't be voting. I'd just like to ask each of the candidates personally for an example of a cause that you've stood up for in the past, any kind of activism, protesting, anything you've taken to the OUSA exec. I'd just like to know how we can tell that you're here for the benefit of the students and the causes you believe in and not just for personal promotion.
The main things that I've been involved with over my university life has been the various peace campaigns that have been going on. And I think it's important for students especially, and we've been trying to raise awareness with students about this, is that we are the future of this country, and we are the future of leading a people. And so we need to be well versed in how society operates and the effects that certain decision making and violence and warfare can have on not only on foreign soil, but what it can have on the domestic population. For example, if we send somebody here, maybe one of these two, as a minister or a prime minister in the future. And they send our troops to go fight in some war which we shouldn't be involved in. and then the amount of people, the amount of soldiers that come back with PTSD from those type of things is incredible. And the amount of people, like, if you talk with them, because the older generation is the most involved with the peace movement, and if you hear the stories of how their fathers and their brothers and their uncles returned from war, it's just incredible what bad decision making can do to a society and how it can affect just even families.
Thank you. Great question, Lucy. I wouldn't say there's been too many events that I've been to or anything like that to say, to campaign on. But I think I would like to hope that we've worked alongside a lot of our writers this year in promoting a lot of things that are relevant to student causes, a lot of stories that have been to the Critic this year. And I think in that role, we've been able to bring some issues to the fore and help the voices that we've been trying to help.
I've been heavily involved in this community for the past 5 years since I came to Dunedin. I'm an Amnesty International member. I have been involved with FriendLink, which is an organisation that in the Dunedin community helps people who have disabilities to socially engage with the rest of the members of community. I have obviously been the president of Rotaract, and during that we went from 10 members to 40 members in 1 year through my presidency, through my initiatives. And within Rotaract, I have helped FriendLink financially, I have helped the Cancer Society of New Zealand raising money in 2 quiz nights, I have helped Cystic Fibrosis, the Curtin Bank, the list goes on and on and on. I'm a very active member of this community, of the Dunedin community, and I will continue to be if elected president. Thank you very much.
Kia ora koutou, ngā mihi nui mō tēnei kaupapa mō te kororo. I just wanted to ask, I'm Francesca Maslin, I'm not a student anymore, so I can't vote, but I'm just really curious in my past experiences on sort of the Māori Students Association, what exactly it is that you can do for your Māori students, particularly in relation to, obviously, everyone's talking about humanities, and so Tutumeru comes under that in terms of lower student numbers. Thank you.
Thank you for the question, Frankie. Yeah, I think that is a really important aspect of our Otago community and Dunedin community. And I think that the biggest thing that I would do as president that I can be part of is communication. And I'll be directly communicating with the Māori students and being part and involved with what you are doing, being involved with your events, being involved with what is important to you, and just opening those lines of communication to further better the student population as a whole. Thank you.
Got it. I think that Māori students and Pacific Island students, especially those two groups specifically, because of the social economic background that the majority come from, because of certain levels of stigma, certain historical injustices, that there needs to be, and I know certain people that that are hired by the university to help postgraduate students and stuff like that with the everyday aspects of life for Māori students, but I don't know what is being done for undergraduate students. So that's something to look into, and that's something that there is for every different community. When there's different communities and there's they have different backgrounds and they have different historical stories, that there needs to be a tailored approach to their needs. And so there should be something along those
lines. Oh, thank you very much for the question. I think the most important thing that you can do as president or, you know, and the exec is work alongside such places like Parohu's on the executive, obviously, and just throw the whole support of OUSA behind it, get down there, get support, those sorts of things, be seen out and about, throw your support behind those sorts of things. That's what I like to do if I was elected.
Cool, all right. The